A very good morning, our dear viewers. If you're just joining us, this is the Rush Hour and we are starting our big issue of the day. I am Agatha Mhaise and I'm going to be taking you through. We are talking about corruption in Uganda and of course as a whole, because we are looking at it on a global scale as well. Yesterday, Transparency International released a corruption perception index, and this revealed the rate at which corruption is still prevailing in so many countries. Uganda maintained its percentage at 26 out of the 100 countries. I believe Uganda was the 141st. Yes, 141st position. That is out of 180 countries. So we are still falling in the last 40 countries in the globe. Here to join me to explain, first of all, this corruption perception index and also to talk about corruption in the country is David Kizito. He's the programs officer at Transparency International Uganda. And also we are joined by Job Matua, an anti-corruption activist. I'm going to let him explain the rest because he does a better introduction of himself. A very good morning, gentlemen.
Morning to you, my in-law, Agatha.
Yes.
You look very beautiful.
Thank you very much.
What are you eating these days?
New year, new looks.
Everything.
You last saw me last year.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, our viewers. Matua Job Richard is my name. I'm the Chief Executive Officer for Organization for Transparency and Advocacy, and the leading aspirant for National Vice Chairman, NRM for Northern Uganda. OFTA, Organization for Transparency and Advocacy, is promoting good governance precisely by fighting corruption. Mm. So you have brought the right person.
To explain it.
Yeah, I will tell the viewers more. I will ask some new corruption issues.
I hear it's live because you come with new evidence.
New evidence.
David, yes. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for hosting us.
Yes.
I also thank the viewers for always showing interest in the issues that are keeping us alive. So we are happy to be here.
I want to start with you. Explain to us, at least give us the highlights of this corruption perception index that I'm holding in my hands.
The corruption perceptions index, it's an annual study that is done by Transparency International.
Yes.
Just for the viewers to know, Transparency International is the leading anti-corruption organization, non-government organization, to emphasize. And we are in more than 100 countries over the globe. So why the Corruption Perceptions Index is that we needed to give governments a measure of corruption, something that we can use to compare how jurisdictions over the world perform when it comes to combating and fighting corruption. So what we do is that the CPI has a certain, can we call it a scientific methodology? But first, we pick data sources from over 13 recognizable agencies or entities. Mm. And these entities have to be operating in more than one jurisdiction. So if you have a report as Transparency International Uganda, and your findings don't cover Kenya, they don't cover Rwanda or any other country, that source can be, can be tapped into the CPI. So currently for Uganda, this year we had about 8 data sources.
Yes.
From which data was picked and our assessment was made. So this data is picked from credible, we can call them credible experts. Mm-hmm. So they won't pick anyone an inch and ask them about their perception about Uganda's corruption and they give responses. So look at those credible business experts within certain agencies that have a certain understanding of how trends are moving within a country. So when we pick these data sources and pick the information, then that information is calculated to get an average score across. Because there are countries that have about 3 sources. Then there are countries that have over 8 sources. So you have to standardize, have an average, and after that, so that's the methodology in brief that we go through to compute the CPI. Mm. So after that, we have 2 things. We have the rank and the score. Mm. So some countries mainly want to hear about the rank because, you know, I think especially when it comes to countries like us,
yes,
Africa, we are more interested in the position.
Who is doing worse, who is doing best,
worse.
Yes.
So when a kid comes from school, even before knowing the marks and what they want to know, which position did you get?
So even if you got 20%,
exactly.
I was the second in class.
I was the second in class. So
yes,
that's where we lose it. So the main point is in the marks. How much did you score? So for Uganda's case, for the last 2 years, we've been stagnant at 26 out of 100. However, our national development plan 3 set us a target of 35 out of 100. But the best we have scored in the last 5 years has been 28. And that was in 2019.
Yes.
So we still have, I think, a long way.
So 2019 we were on 28.
Yeah.
2020, 2021 we were on 27. And
yes,
then we dropped.
We
Why
dropped.
Is Uganda stagnating in that particular area?
There are various factors that lead to that stagnation. And when you look at the long list of recommendations that we have, previously we had recommendations on the independence of and corruption agencies. Because we see that sometimes they don't have that flexibility to ably perform on their mandate. I think even within our country, we've seen scenarios where sometimes cases are dismissed. You know, cases, sometimes we just say, okay, we have lost interest in this case. That has an impact on the trust you build within the people that come to invest in your country. Then we have issues of the capacity of these agencies to perform on their mandate beyond the independence. Sometimes they are under-resourced, so you find challenges when it comes to investigating cases of corruption. I think we have seen cases where over 7 years we don't have judgments and convictions on these cases. I think even the Kato C case is still under petition in court. So that has a statement it makes when it comes to the fight against corruption.
So for you in this year, you saw the justice system as the reason as to why corruption keeps prevailing in different countries.
Every year we come up with themes,
yes,
and these are normally global themes.
Mm.
And we look at what's trending globally that could be impacting on the fight against corruption. 2020, you notice we had issues of COVID.
Yes, we had
and
COVID.
Every country was kind of struggling to respond to COVID.
Yes.
Then 2021, we had issues
human
of
rights.
Equity. Yeah. So it spoke on issues of human rights and things like that.
Yes.
2022, we had the Ukraine war, Russia-Ukraine
conflict
war
and security.
So every country was trying to respond on how can they now combat the effects of the Russia-Ukraine war.
Yes.
Well, we had issues of inflation. So these are normally global trends.
Yes.
So when we come in this year, we have issues of injustice.
Mm-hmm.
And in every country, there are those aspects of injustices that are happening.
Well,
we are seeing issues of, in the Middle East, there are issues happening there. We have seen issues in the US where they have these prolonged court cases. It's almost everywhere. So that's what informed our theme. And these themes still speak in the national context, even in Uganda.
Well, that is very beautiful. Thank you so much, David. I would like to bring in Job now. Job, we have stagnated at 26 out of 100. Are we improving or are we failing? Because we have to pick a side. We can't say we are just in one place.
Yeah, thank you very much, my in-law, Agatha, for this question. Number one, I want to first thank you for developing interest in moderating political talks talk shows on such things. In Uganda, we are running low in terms of female journalists taking interest in that direction.
Mm.
I want to appreciate that very sincerely.
Thank you very much.
I see this in another related television, which I may not mention here, because I don't want to advertise another
A local TV station.
Yes, a local TV station
yes,
in this country. And I thank you. And it's also my in-law.
Oh.
So I don't know whether the in-laws only want to tell that. to the viewers, when I come here to talk about Uganda and corruption, I want it to be consistent with my belief, my modus operandi, and the political ideology of a better Uganda for all. Countrymen and women, corruption in Uganda is at industrial scale level, large, major, big level of corruption. This is what I want to tell you. And I am not surprised by the finding of Transparency International.
Mm-hmm.
In fact,
It has reflected, it has justified what I have always been talking, including here on this station. So the corruption in this country is not a small thing we should talk about. That's why when we are talking it, we must talk at, talk it with real intensity. Now, that's one. Two, when you look at the result of the Transparency International,
yes,
this result here, countrymen and women, this result here of Transparency International, you'll realize that in East Africa here we are doing badly.
That's very true.
With the worst being Somalia. Somalia has a score of 11%. And is ranked 180.
So what's the country globally?
So I'm asking myself, a very religious country, Islamic, too Islamic, the Sharia does not allow corruption. So what could be influencing the corruption in Somalia? Could it be the failing of the state? Well, there is actually a failed state in that country. On the other side, Somaliland, which Transparency International, I'm requesting in the next coming year, rank Somaliland. Somaliland is one of the cleanest countries we talk about in this country in terms of democracy, in terms of you know, civil service. I can tell you in Somaliland you can even leave your doors open and you go out, you come back without anything taken from your house. So in East Africa here, if you remove Rwanda, actually Professor Venances Mariamureba concluded on Twitter yesterday that if you remove Rwanda, then you would say East Africa is a very corrupt
because Rwanda is above average with 53.
Yes.
Yes.
So you, if you remove Rwanda, then you would say East Africa is the most corrupt region in Africa here. Now, aside that, countrymen and women, the issue of corruption in Uganda must therefore be approached at the right level and with precision if we want to deal with it. So from there, I want to give you one thing. Article 163 of the Constitution of the Republic of Uganda establishes the Office of Auditor General. That is one agency that is dealing with fighting corruption. Article 223 of the Constitution establishes the Office of Inspectorate of Government. Now, this is the core agency of government that is supposed to fight corruption. To what extent has IGG fought corruption? This question we must ask and must be answered.
But it was IGG just recently that came out and told us that over about billions, actually, I'll get the trillions, is lost to corruption every year.
Madam Betty Olivo Namisango Kamia, the Inspector General of Government, actually alluded to it that we lose 10 trillion every financial year to corruption. So now, when you look at this, Article 163, Article 223, then together with the the Inspectorate of Government Act 2002, Article 41, Clause 1A, and then Section 3 of Access to Information Act, we have existing laws to fight corruption. Then the question is, why is Uganda still doing badly in terms of corruption? What is that which is happening that we must solve? And I am going to give to countrymen and women, this fact.
Yes.
Yeah. So therefore, I want to say that the country has a laws to fight corruption. The country has a criminal justice system agencies to fight corruption. We have the CID, we have the DPP, we have the IGG, then we have the courts, then we have Auditor General. So what are these institutions doing in the fight?
So we have the tools.
Corruption.
We have all the tools necessary.
Yes, we
so
have
where are we going wrong?
Now, let me tell you this. Corruption, therefore, is greed, is theft. I don't know if Transparency International could next time call it the ranking of theft in the world, it would be better. Because to make it romantic and call it corruption, embezzlement, some people may not see the dangers with it. I can tell you the corruption we have is now leading to bad health. UNSB is clearing substandard products brought in Uganda. In fact, there is one case which is very ugly that I need to cite here. Last year, UNSB, UNBS cleared one of the concentrates imported for preparing beverages in the country. So the corrupt people in UNBS cleared this thing before subjecting it to laboratory test. So when they did a laboratory test thereafter, they found that the product they had cleared was not good for human consumption. My in-law Agatha, that's why we are seeing cancer even in children. Cancer is a disease for the old people. Our people are dying of cancer because of corruption. This is what we must know. Substandard goods are being cleared. Ugandans are being exposed to counterfeit.
Mm-hmm.
And can I tell you, yes, that concentrate was cleared for a company that high-end people go to. I don't want to name the company because I don't want to decampaign their business here.
Mm.
Yeah? So by the time the UNBS followed that thing, beverages have already been prepared for people to drink. People have already consumed, only for you to realize that cancer is eating us up. So therefore, bad health is one danger of corruption.
Mm-hmm.
Because of, even if you go to the hospital, drugs are not there.
Because of corruption.
If you go to Eastern Congo and the Western South Sudan, that's Maridi, almost all the health centers there are running on drugs with the label government of Uganda, not for sale.
Can
you imagine? The drugs which are bought using your money, my money, and David's money, we the taxpayer, end up being stolen and sold in
another country.
And a system is running in Maridi. Health centers in Maridi are running with the drugs labeled government of Uganda, not for sale.
Mm.
So therefore, I want to say that corruption is leading to poor service delivery. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Very poor service delivery. Poor infrastructure, poor roads. I can tell you that the procurement of the road from Koboko to Yumbe to Moyo is being infected with corruption to the extent that the company, UNIRA, is going to award the contract now, obtained it corruptly.
And you have evidence of this?
I have evidence, and the report of PPDA, the report of State House Anti-Corruption Unit, was ignored by Minister of Finance. With an excuse that they cannot antagonize World Bank, because somebody in World Bank threatened that the contract will be, not the grant will be cancelled if it is not awarded to that particular company. You can imagine somebody in World Bank now influencing which company should go and do the road from Koboko, Yumbe, Moyo. What level of corruption is that? Involving World Bank grant. And the company is going to construct the road almost to 500 billion, a road of 103.5 kilometers. Almost 500 billion is going to be used to construct that road. I don't know what kind of colors they are going to lay on that road. I want to see
what they will look forward to seeing then, that course. Mr. Matua, I'm going to take a break here. I'm going to come back and you're going to complete the list of things that are being affected due to corruption. And then later on, we are going to be looking at where we are going wrong, given all the tools that Mr. Matua here has already told us we have. We are talking about corruption in Uganda. We shall continue right after this break.
Thank you.
Mr. Matua.